Okay, so we continue with integrable structure of string theory in ADS5 process 5. I recall that I finished my lecture with presenting you the sigma model action, which is supposed to describe strings moving in this space. And I finished with presenting you equations of motion for this theory. They are in terms of these projections of the Maurer-Cartan form. And these equations of motion can be written in the form of the conservation law. And this is appears nothing else as a conservation law for a neuter charge corresponding to the global PSU 2,2/4 symmetry of this sigma model. Now, I would like to explain why this sigma model represents a two-dimensional integrable system. And for that, I need to recall or explain the way we show that integrable system, or we show that a certain dynamical system represented by a system of partial differential equations is actually integrable. And this is done by exhibiting for this system the so-called Lux representation. So Lux is the name of Peter Lux. So Peter Lux was the first one who suggested this way to exhibit integrability. And this appears to be an extremely useful way because in this way you can construct, not only construct integrals of motion, but you can also use them in order to solve the corresponding system of partial differential equations. So now I'm trying to explain this concept of Lux. So suppose we have a fundamental problem which consists in the following. So we have a system of two first order differential equations, which are actually matrix differential equations. So here psi is a column vector. It depends on sigma and tau. So sigma and tau, you can think about these variables as describing, for instance, our two-dimensional world sheet. So for instance, sigma is periodic because we are talking about closed string. So sigma is running from 0 to 2 pi. And tau is a world sheet time. And here, L sigma and L tau are two matrices. The size I'm not specifying, let it be some n, so these are matrices, n by n matrices, and psi is a column vector. And we would like also that our matrices here, and correspondingly the solution, will depend on one additional complex parameter, which I call z. So z has a name, it's called spectral parameter. So once again, these are two matrices, L sigma and L tau, and we want to solve this system of differential equations. The first question you may ask, is this system has a chance to have a solution? And in order to have a solution, these two equations must be compatible. And compatibility means that if you take the first equation and differentiate it with respect to tau, and take the second one and differentiate it with respect to sigma, the left-hand side must coincide. Of course, we assume that we are looking for a good solution, differentiable with respect to sigma and tau twice. And if we apply the derivatives now to the right-hand side, then on the right-hand side, we obtain the following terms. And for these to coincide, for arbitrary sigma and tau, the right-hand side must coincide as well. And that leads, this implies that this is possible if these matrices L sigma and tau satisfy this equation. And this equation must be satisfied, this equation is called zero curvature or Lux representation. And, what we require that actually this equation must be satisfied identically in the variable z, in this spectral parameter, due to the satisfaction of the partial differential equations for the matrix elements of this matrices L sigma and L tau. Well, let me give you one example. For instance, Let's consider the famous Sine-Gordon equation. So we have one real field phi. Phi tau tau means the second derivative of phi with respect to tau. Phi sigma sigma means has the same meaning, double derivative with respect to sigma. And this is a non-linear partial differential equation which we would like to solve. Now let us introduce 2x2 matrices L sigma and L tau, which we construct with the help of Pauli matrices sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3. And phi tau is derivative with respect to tau, and phi sigma derivative with respect to sigma. Here you see this potential sine of the half of the argument. And L sigma and L tau depend also on the spectral parameter Z in this particular way. Now the statement is that if you compute the left-hand side of this equation here, you will find out that it is equal to the following 2x2 matrix, where the first element is equal to minus 4i beta phi tau tau minus phi sigma sigma plus m squared over beta sine beta phi. And here you have 0, 0. And here 4i beta phi tau tau minus phi sigma sigma plus m squared beta sine beta phi. And this is, as I said, is d tau L sigma minus d sigma L tau plus L sigma L tau. Sorry. So you see that the spectral parameter completely disappeared, and then this equation here, the left-hand side, will be equal to zero, provided the equation of motion for the field phi is satisfied. So Sine-Gordon equation, if it's satisfied, then this two-dimensional current, which consists of the components L tau, L sigma, if I denote it as L mu, this two-dimensional current, has a zero curvature, because what is written down here is a curvature of this two-dimensional current. It has a vanishing curvature, provided the Sine-Gordon equation is satisfied, and this satisfaction is identical in the variables, because the right-hand side simply doesn't depend on this. So this is an example of what Lux representation means and how it is constructed, for instance, for the case of this equation, Okay. Now, the question is why it is useful. What can you show with this equation? What you can achieve with this Lux representation? If you manage to find the Lux representation for your original partial differential equation, then you can construct such a quantity as a monodromy. And it's done in the following way. So you just take the component L sigma of this Lux connection, and you integrate it all along sigma direction from 0 to 2 pi, but you do it by keeping the order of integration. So what is written down here, this exponent with an arrow above, means the path integration. So path integration means that when you integrate, you preserve the order. So I think in the quantum field theory, you are very well acquainted with the notion of the time ordering exponent. Could you raise your hand? Who knows what is a time ordering exponent? Well, what is written down is the same, except instead of time, you have space direction. So it's the same thing, but now sigma plays the role of time. Okay, so you have such an object. As we assumed, this matrix L sigma, it depends on the spectral parameter Z, and therefore our monodromy, which is a matrix also, it is Z-dependent. And if we differentiate this monodromy with respect to time, then it appears that this form of the monodromy, given by this path-ordered exponent, results in the following expression of the right hand, on the right-hand side. So what you see on the right hand side is a commutator of the matrix L tau evaluated at sigma equals to zero with the original monodromy matrix T on Z. Now this formula actually can be rather easily proved in the following way. So maybe I'll do it quickly on the blackboard. So you have T given by path over its exponential integral from 0 to 2 pi L sigma. Let me not write this variable Z. Then you differentiate this with respect to T, and differentiate T with respect to tau, and you do this in the following way. So you split the integral as integral from, let me write in this way, from 0 to sigma, L sigma, and from sigma to 2 pi.
You could write it bigger maybe for everyone else on the big arrows, the back arrows.
You want me to write bigger?
Slightly
bigger. Okay, sure. Let's do it again. So d tau t, I write it in the following way. Integral over d sigma from 0 to pi here. Integral from sigma to pi L sigma d tau L sigma integral from 0 to sigma L sigma d sigma d sigma. Okay? So this is a differentiation of the result with respect to tau. So basically, I represent, roughly speaking, this integral. You understand what I'm doing? I'm splitting it at an arbitrary point sigma, and I differentiate the matrix, which is an exponent with respect to tau. So I differentiate exponents, and it means that I have to differentiate L sigma, it gets down. And then I need to integrate over this split point. So and this means this integral from 0 to 2 pi. And then by zero curvature condition, I replace d tau L sigma by, so I substitute here, d sigma L tau plus commutator L tau comma L sigma. So I substitute it instead of L tau L sigma. Let me probably write it again. D sigma exponential sigma 2 pi L sigma d sigma d sigma L tau plus commutator L tau L sigma exponential integral 0 sigma L sigma d sigma. And if you look now at this expression, you realize that these exponents and expression in the middle is nothing else as a derivative d sigma applied to exponential sigma 2 pi L sigma d sigma L tau exponential 0 sigma L sigma d sigma. Indeed, when you differentiate this expression, you will have three terms. Once this derivative acts on the lower bound of integration, and the matrix L sigma gets down at the lower bound with a minus sign because it's a lower integration bound. When it acts on L tau, you get this term here, and when it acts on this exponent, it acts on the upper bound of the integration, and the matrix L sigma gets down at the upper bound. And you get this commutator term. So it's precisely this expression here. But then you realize that what you have obtained is a total derivative. And therefore, the result is given by the value of this function once evaluated at sigma equals to 2 pi,
minus the value of this function evaluated at sigma equals to zero. We assume that L tau depends on the fields locally. Fields are periodic in sigma, and therefore matrix L tau is periodic in sigma, so it satisfies the periodicity condition. L tau on sigma equals to zero equals to L tau sigma equals to 2 pi. And as a result, you obtain precisely that commutator expression. You see, when you, for instance, substitute sigma equals to pi, this exponent disappears. Well, this becomes t. Another way around. Yeah?
All these differentials here are path-ordered, right?
Yes. All differentials here are path-ordered. In order to make it explicit, let me therefore write down arrows. Absolutely. Yes.
Now, so we have this equation, and it's clear from here that, for instance, if you take a trace of monodromy matrix or any other invariant, then the time derivative, or say, of the trace of the monodromy matrix or of any other invariant of the monodromy matrix will be time independent. If you take a trace, for instance, the trace of the commutator is zero, and therefore trace of the monodromy matrix is a conserved quantity. But since t depends on z in a continuous way, you have actually a family of the integral of motions, of the integrals of motion, which is continuous in the variable z. So for instance, if z has a meaningful expansion around zero, it can be expanded in the power series, then this expansion of the trace of the monodromy matrix will generate you an infinite sequence of integrals of motion, quantities which do not depend on time. And so this is the way how you use the Lux representation to exhibit that actually this equation for which you constructed this Lux representation is an integrable partial differential equation. Any questions? This is important. Yeah?
Could you repeat this point? So what happens when you take the trace?
If you take the trace,
so what we have obtained is the following thing. G tau monodromy matrix is equal to commutator of L tau comma T on Z. If I take a trace, for instance, then I will get G tau trace on T on Z. What I get on the right hand side, trace of the commutator, zero. Okay. So that means that the trace of the monodromy matrix does not depend on time. So I constructed this monodromy matrix by using matrix L sigma. L sigma, of course, depends on the original fields, like for instance for Sine-Gordon model, it depends on the field phi and its derivative. It was dependent
on field and its derivative, its tau derivative, yes.
And of course, during the time evolution, the field phi changes, its derivative changes as well. But the quantity we constructed out of this phi and phi dot, it doesn't depend on time. I can construct other invariants, not necessarily trace of t. I can take a determinant of t. And more generally, I can build up the quantity of this sort. I can just take the determinant of t on z minus mu multiplied by identity matrix.
Here it is.
Yeah,
where mu is another complex parameter. So therefore, this quantity here depends on two complex parameters, z and mu. And then the statement is due to such an evolution equation for the monodromy matrix, the quantity gamma, depending on z and mu, is time independent. So this quantity does not depend on time. This equation by itself defines an algebraic curve in C2. And this curve has a name. It's in the theory of integrable models. It's called spectral curve. Spectral curve because it's a time independent and it encodes an information about integrals of motion of our dynamical system. Yeah?
So ask what could be the practical strategies to construct this laxity
matrix? Oh, practical strategy is called trial and error. This is the only practical strategy people know. No, there is another practical way to construct for some models, lax matrices and complicated integrable models can be obtained from extremely simple ones, like free series, by means of the procedure known as a Hamiltonian reduction. This could be one way to make a construction of the lax matrix. So you have a big phase space and very, very simple dynamical system. And then you have a group acting, a Lie group acting on this extended phase space under which the dynamical system is invariant. And what you do a reduction then of the corresponding system by the action of this Lie group. And on the reduced space, you can obtain a rather non-trivial integrable model, and you can also induce the lax representation. Yeah, this is a possible way to do it. But in general, finding the lax representation is the same as to answer a question if your concrete if your concrete model is integrable or not. And this is the most difficult question, because in general, there is no method which you can always apply and answer this question. Yeah?
What is the interpretation of this spectral parameter Z? Because it doesn't seem like it played any role in this calculation.
You mean the variable Z?
Yeah.
Well, since L sigma, our matrix which we are using in order to build up our matrix here, this one, it depends on Z. As a result, the whole monodromy is also Z-dependent. So what you can do now, you can, for instance, if this dependence on Z is analytic, say around zero, what you can do, you can expand this trace of the monodromy matrix in a power series. And then, since the whole monodromy is conserved independently on the value of Z, it means that every coefficient in this power series is an integral of motion. So what I mean is that you simply take the monodromy, actually its trace, say, and you expand it in a convergent power series. Then, since this is time independent for any z, then every coefficient here is an integral of motion. And since this is a series, what you do, you generate an infinite set of integrals. Infinite set of constants of motion, things which do not change during the time evolution of the system. So it's an extremely powerful method. As soon as you know lax representation, you have a sequence of integrals of motion. Basically, this is what Lux got the Abel Prize for. Okay, now I would like just to say that yes, our string theory about radius 5 versus 5 is precisely an example of such an integrable model, because you can construct for it the corresponding Lux representation. It is constructed as a certain sum of the graded components, A0, A2, and A1 and A3, with coefficients, and all the coefficients are uniquely determined in terms of one spectral parameter Z for the corresponding current L alpha to satisfy the zero curvature condition. The requirement to satisfy the zero curvature condition, as a consequence of the string equations of motion which I showed you before, leads to the unique determination of these coefficients L0, L1, and so on. And they are given in terms of one free parameter, Z, which precisely becomes a spectral parameter of the model. So that means that this string theory is integrable, and one can construct an infinite sequence of integrals of motion. Okay? This is something to verify, and you can consider this as an exercise. It's not so complicated. If you know equations of motion, you use them, and then you find the solution for these coefficients. Good. What I presented you was a general sigma model. It includes everything. It includes bosonic fields. It includes fermionic fields. Now I would like to go a little bit away from this abstract presentation of the whole general construction and talk about concrete solutions of the bosonic part of this sigma model, just to see how the bosonic strings in the areas 5 process 5 space behave themselves. And my presentation will consist of three topics. First, I consider the simplest possible string configurations which correspond to rigid strings. I will explain what it means and how this guy moves. And in particular, I will spend some time on explaining what is the Dubsek-Lebanov-Polyakov string solution which played a very important role providing a very strong evidence that n equals 4 theory, or in general gauge theories, has something to do with motion in the area space. That was an extremely important paper. And then I will tell you that actually both rigid strings and in particular Gapsack-Lebanov-Polyakov string, these are all examples of a rather generic class of solutions which are known under the name finite gap solutions. So in the theory of integrability, there is a notion of the finite gap integration, finite gap solutions, and these particular solutions constitute an instance of these generic finite gap solutions. Good. So let's now go for our sigma model for strings on areas pi crosses pi and completely forget about fermionic degrees of freedom. If you forget about fermions and switch them off and write down explicitly what this sigma model is, then you recognize something which you have seen most probably in your courses on string theory. You see just very standard expression for the sigma model action, where the target space is areas 5 process 5, described by this metric GMN. And since we deal here with a product of two manifolds, ADS and S5, this metric splits into ADS5 case, in ADS5 part and the sphere part. And if you wish, you can pick up the global coordinates for both spaces, say time direction in the ADS and angle directions, theta phi and var phi, and the same is for the phi sphere. Now you can also realize the ADS5 space in S5 as well via embedding. In particular, phi sphere can be realized by its embedding in the six-dimensional Euclidean space. So you have six coordinates xm satisfying this constraint. This constraint, of course, defines for you a phi sphere in the six-dimensional space. Index m, summation index m, runs from 1 to 6 here. And analogously, the space ADS5 can be realized as an embedding surface in the Minkowski space with two times, R42. And for that, you introduce the coordinates y, satisfying this constraint here, where the metric eta mn has two minuses in the signature, minus one, the first one, and the last one. The relation with these parameterizations of the metric of the metrics is established by means of the following formula. So you have six coordinates satisfying one constraint, and you can resolve these constraints here and here by means of parameterization of these complex combinations in terms of the angles. So the statement is that these parameterizations resolve these constraints, and simultaneously the matrix induced from R6 and R42 into the surface, into these surfaces, coincide precisely with the expressions given by this formula. Okay? So this is the way, yeah?
And can I ask when you decided to compactify in S5 or no, for example, 2 Calabi-Yau S1? Or
in principle, you can do whatever you want, but we would like to consider areas 5 cross S5 space, because areas 5 cross S5, as I said yesterday, has an isometry group which coincides precisely with a conformal group with respect to which Young-Mills theory is invariant. So the isometry group of the 5 sphere is SO6. And SO6 is the R-symmetry group of N equals 4 theory. If I would take some other manifold, I will not achieve the same kinematic symmetry group as I have in my N equals 4 theory. So that's why it's a 5-sphere. That's why it's a 5-sphere. Now, anti-de Sitter space, you can visualize here this kind of one-sheeted hyperboloid. And well, it's clear it has a circle, it has a throat here. This is because if you look at this metric here and you put all y's to zero except corresponding to this first direction and the last direction, you will see that what you will be then describing is a circle, and this circle precisely corresponds to the time direction here. This is for me this plane. Which cuts this road will be described by the coordinates y0 and y5. So coordinates of the area space I parameterize by y0, y1, y2, y3, y4, and y5. Okay. So 0 here is distinguished because I would like to remind myself that it's related to the time direction. Okay. Now, we have to remember that we deal with a string theory. That means that in addition to equations of motion, for our fields, embedding fields xm and ym, we also have Virasoro constraints. So explicitly, in terms of these embedding fields, Virasoro constraints are given by these two equations here. Now, what I would like to consider now is the so-called rigid strings. So consider the situation where we have such string, a simplest string solution, where string just has a simplest possible time dependence concentrated on the area space. So y0 and y5 are only coordinates on the area space which are excited. Tau is a Wöhlschmidt time. And I also remind myself that if I look at this metric here, this metric, say for five sphere, it has three commuting isometries corresponding to the directions phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3. These directions corresponding to these angles phi 1 and phi 2 and phi 3 are isometric. You can shift these coordinates by a constant, and the metric will not be changed because these coordinates phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3 they enter into the metric only under the only in terms of differentials. Where they are? Well, it's written in a little bit different way.
On the right.
Yes, here for instance. Phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3. this phi 1 should be identified with one of these directions. This phi 2 should be phi, var phi should be phi 3, and theta should be phi 1. So there are three directions which are isometric. There are three isometries, and these isometries actually commute. And what you can do now, you can assume that you set up the so-called rotating string ansatz with three non-zero NOTA charges corresponding to these three isometric angles phi I. And the corresponding ansatz consists in just picking up the time dependence in terms of the rotations with three frequencies, omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3. And you assume that the radial directions, x1, x2, and x3, represented by this little axis, they have no time dependence. They depend only on sigma. Only on sigma, no time dependence. This is an ansatz to describe a solution. And the condition that you are on the five sphere for this ansatz results in the fact that these little axes are now span the two sphere, right? Some of these three little squares of these three little axes must be equal to one. So this is a so-called rotating string ansatz, and it describes a rigid string. Rigid means that string keeps its profile, looks like this, looks like this rod, and it rotates in three orthogonal directions in this six-dimensional space-time. So one direction is described by the frequency omega 1, another direction is described by frequency omega 2, and the third one, if I can do it like this, is described by by the frequency omega 3. And since we have three isometries, that means that we must have three conserved NOTA charges, and these three conserved NOTA charges correspond to these isometrical symmetries. They are described here as this spin ratio of J, three spins corresponding to these three